Okay, so starting off, robotic assisted design technology, it's not something that's been around for ages, but it's a new concept, I would say, in the last few years. Just to start off with, does anyone have any connection with anyone who's suffering from paraplegia? For instance, anyone in the audience at all? No, okay. Thank you, sir. So, just ask that. So I would start off. Murphy's Law, something goes wrong. So moving on to this, with the introduction, partial paralysis, I'm going to go through these sections and I'll come back after that. So when you look at paralysis, there's one or two areas to look at. The first thing is how far the paralysis is spread and what areas it affects. So when you're looking at spinal cord injuries, generally in one certain area, not to be confused with orthopedia, but paraplegia is basically at one level down. So you generally have movement of your arms, but you don't have movement of anything else below the knees. Primarily, the injuries is basically due to spinal cord injuries, so it's SCI, standard shock. So just running through some stats. You're looking at roughly 250,000 to 500,000 new cases here. These are reported cases, by the way. World Health Organization mentions this is the general criteria, but when you take the unaccounted incidents, accidents, and things like that, I'm pretty sure this figure balloons as well. The high-risk areas for males and females, you're looking at 20 to 29 and after for males, and females 15 to 19 and 60. So it all depends on how you have come into this accident and how you have affected. So if you take a look at some of these statistics, basically the areas you're looking at, almost 70% covers vehicular accidents and fall-related accidents. The rest of them go to violence at home, injuries to maybe sporting accidents and things like that. So 70% is purely on vehicle and accidents. The options for treatment currently, you're looking at surgery. So surgery is a very expensive and tedious process for two reasons. The first reason being, once you do complete surgery, there's a massive amount of physiotherapy involved. And it's a very long process to getting, I would say, a certain degree of mobility back into your system. You can go on medication, that's basically pain relief, like continuously pack up on painkillers or anything else like that. Side effects would be gastritis or anything along those lines, so it's not really a permanent solution. The third one would be physical therapy. So, physical therapy again, it would depend on your accident. So, for example, if you've completely lost your movement, your legs and things like that, even going and getting physiotherapy or physical therapy might be very difficult. And the final one is occupational therapy. So sometimes accidents could occur in a particular industry or in a particular workplace. So there you could get the occupational therapy, but again, a long-term process. So right here, so to summarize it, between quadriplegia and paraplegia, you're looking at two main differences. That's basically the effect, how far you are affected in terms of your disability, and how far it goes down as well. Okay, so, robotic industry. Personally, when I think of robotics, I've only thought of two things in my life. I'm pretty sure some of the crowd at the back might agree with me. These are the two images that I've generated. But robotics has changed dramatically over the time that we are looking at this and the time that we thing I'm going to do is I'm going to analyze the top three, I would say the top three models in the industry, because these have come up over the last 3 years, and these three products have basically taken over the market, so very limited globally. Yeah, so when you can choose one, this is by Exo Biogenics. The major thing that we focus on is the cost. They're talking about $100,000, and this is a retail market. That's for the full-fledged functionality with the charging unit and everything else. You do have other sections that add on to it. Like for example, if you're looking at the armors and the arm connectors and the battery guard, that again adds on to the cost. The key benefit I would say, just for an example, who here believes in cloud technology? We do a lot of storage on site, we have a lot of data saved on site. But is there anyone in the audience who thinks cloud storage is safe? You can raise your hands. No one. Okay, great. So what this system does is it focuses on cloud storage because you cannot retain this much information on site. You need, it should be accessible, it should be portable, and it should be available. So most of these systems take data, look at big data analytics, and it basically uploads it to a system on the cloud. So you have information on the cloud. The second and third systems is by a company called Revoq and Indigo. Again, look at the cost, you're talking about $85,000 for it, it's a massive amount. The next thing is, so the next thing that we look at is that section. So we catch the Revoq as well as Indigo. So when you look at the advantages and the disadvantages, I mentioned two things. One is if you are stuck at home and you are unable to move, you're looking at a very high degree of mobility. So getting a certain amount of normalcy back into your life. When you look at the psychological aspects now, for example, we, I think, engineers and consultants in general, they look at sorting out solution, but they don't look at the post-care aspect. So you've been stuck in, you've been doing your work around, you've been everything normally, and then suddenly you get into an accident, and then you can't do anything at all. So the psychological aspect of the treatment is something completely different. So the advantage there is when you build a certified, so you build the unit, and you're all of a sudden affecting them mentally. You're helping them in that regard as well. Disadvantage. We're talking about a very high cost, $8,000 to $100,000 is a massive cost. That's a substantial investment. I did some research into small units. For example, if you're entering one leg or another area, there are small units that are available between $30,000 to $40,000, but again, it's very high. Support and physiotherapy, again, investment costs, you need to take the victim, you need to get them involved, all of those. And the last one is the materials movement. So for an example, you're noticing the urgent slab, the general weight of such a unit is 23 kilograms. That's a bare minimum. So you're talking about a victim who's already injured, who has lost the ability to move their legs. They have arm supports, but moving a 23 kilogram object with, of course, there is support from the unit, but that is a fairly large, let's say, large risk as well. So areas of research. These are basically research areas that you might be interested in the future. So you can house the plans. There were two primary aspects of our supplies. The first one was you have a primary supply that's basically non-rechargeable. The important thing there is it can retain more energy and can probably give you a longer life. But the thing is the replacement. If it dies down in the field, walking somewhere, the replacement aspect is non-existent. The second aspect is rechargeable. That is, it retains the charge for a short period, but you have that option of recharge. Again, they should come if it happens in the field. How are you going to recharge this? How are you going to sort of gain your mobility there? So exoskeletons, traditionally you're looking at steel, aluminium frames, and that is great, but then titanium frames is the best option, but again you're looking at a massive cost. The hydraulics part, you have two aspects, you have the motor and the servos, you have the motor, that aspect, and you have the fluid actuators. The fluid actuators are more accurate because the movement is no fluid, but the problem is if there is any leak or damage to the unit, that will affect the user as well. When you have the servo motors, it will be more effective, but the I would say the movement is more rigid. So price and cost are always important thing for any researcher. That research that you're putting there would have to sort of drop down the total investment into one unit to make it more practical and more affordable. And the final one is joint flexibility. So we have a certain movement, we have a certain way of doing things, and when you add a robotic extension on that, the movement might be more rigid. So fixing that or maybe researching into a sharper area will make a difference. Right. So other applications. I think military is one of the largest. I've seen United States have come up with several models. So they're looking at Air Force, Navy and Army in three different aspects, and they have actually built their exoskeleton models based on the field conditions that each type would be affected with. So that's amazing. And the second one is industrial. So we have got industrial work in all development, construction, and certain models here based on currently with them. Continuing remarks. Basically, the exoskeleton is something that can affect a lot of people, but can be changed. To share a very short personal story, I came back to 2011. Before focusing on cloud security, I was actually in this area, looking at the design, building units, so then looking at the updates, some things like that. So when I came back to one, it was a short project. Unfortunately, my mother also went through this, and now at the current practice in 2011, 2017, she has been confined for a year now. So as a researcher, I think for you all, especially if you research in this area, you are not just looking for growth, you're looking at changing people's lifestyle. We are here for 7-8 years maximum. And changing that would be probably something that you would have. References and, of course, acknowledgements, like thank the other from the same universe to share a lot on the technical side. And
thank you very much for a fascinating paper. I came here especially to listen to you because I'm the Vice President of the National Institute of Paraplegic Support. We have roughly 60 paraplegics now and out there. They would all have stars in their eyes if they listen to this paper. But of course, the cost will put them right, okay. But they're looking at the moment, for example, they're going, all are going for the equal steps, which is doesn't work at all and gives them false hopes. And as you know, their lives are terrible. They are normal people, but completely paralyzed and sick. And we just provide them support, occupational therapy, and try to involve them. Most of them are involved in things like IT and all which they can do. So this is a fascinating paper. So I just hope that like all your technologies, that you would manage to get this down to somewhere around, say, $10,000 would be feasible for even a Sri Lankan paraplegic. You follow what I mean? They get a lot of support,
right?
But $100,000 is out.
Right.
So I really hope that this technique would evolve and become. I think the 23 kilo weight might be a problem for some, and you might have to go for a diet. But otherwise, this is a fascinating and
any other questions or comments,
please? Yes, come in. You said 78 years maximum. I mean, at least 90 years.
So I have 5 years more.
Okay, so any other
questions about this?
So are you proposing any model?
Right, actually that was what I wanted to finish off with. So this research that I've done was maybe secondary research, but I just got back from Singapore. I've spoken to a fund company there. They are looking at investing in India up to a certain amount. So I'm actually sharing my details for a reason. I'd like to get involved with people like you said, so myself, who are looking at research here, and we might be able to get at least some initial funding from there. So I'm looking at helping one way or the other. Now, maybe not directly researching it, but trying to find funding or something that will support someone with.
Just that not the main cause for paraplegia in Sri Lanka is fall of trees. And it's the poorest people, the tree climbers, you know, they are the ones who get, and road traffic accidents. Okay. But falling off trees is the main reason.
So, after studying the models available, are you proposing any design?
Not at the moment. The research was just at this stage. I'll be looking at it in the future in the next 6 months or so once I get this investment in. Because I'll have engaged with people who are actually doing this type of research. That is going to be the technical aspect. So it will be an ongoing process, I'd say.
So you have gone through the technical aspects?
I went through some basic technical aspects. So that's actually why when I was doing the presentation before, I was like, this session is not going to be pure technical. It's all right. So I've gone through some basic aspects of how the hydraulics works, how the system works, what program we have, but not up to the aspect where you could actually video it. It's still ongoing, so it's fairly complicated.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.